Hello, everybody.
Hello.
I'm Brown Pastor, and this is the College of Complexes.
Well, we can hear you.
Yeah. And we have one rule here, and that is one fool at a time.
The microphone is on. Okay. All right, everybody. Andy? All right. I meant to ask Mr. O'Donnell, our speaker, further ado, our speaker, Tom O'Donnell.
Hi everyone, my name is Tom O'Donnell. I am a 19-year-old independent researcher, and I've put together a presentation explaining root causes and solutions to world problems like poverty, crime, a bad environment, etc. So I'm going to start now. So this first board talks about the existing wealth of the United States. So starting over here with important wealth facts, it's kind of like the table of contents of what I'm going to be discussing on this. So number one is why being rich is so great. Number two, the sources of life and wealth. Number three, today's average person. Four, the existing land condition. Five, a quote by Abraham Lincoln. Six, land value. Seven, wealth acquisition today. Eight, the law and inheritance. Nine, an informed person. And 10, wealth acquisition tomorrow. So to start with a preface, I'm focusing on the rule, not the exceptions, an open mind. It's kind of out of the box thinking, and common sense is required for this. So then just a quote by Einstein, he said, if you can't explain it simply, you don't understand it well enough. So number one, the definition of rich, it's the best of everything, you're financially free and secure, you have no money worries. And then here's just a picture describing a rich life. So a family's got a nice house, car, plenty of food and clothes, and their thoughts are life's great. Number two, the sources of life slash wealth. They are land, air, water, sun, knowledge, labor, and money. If you lost one component, you'd die. Example, no sun equals no life. Because if you didn't have the sun, then you couldn't grow food and you'd die. So all are just as important to the body as the heart, kidney, or liver is. And humans use their knowledge and labor abilities to convert resources from land into food, house, etc., for money to achieve their needs and desires. Then today's average person, their desires are love, safety, happiness, freedom, etc. Their abilities are to think and act. Their needs are land slash source of life. Their primary knowledge obtained from parents, school, church, etc. is land slash source of life is not inherited. You have to buy it with money. And I'm a free person, but dependent on money, just like everyone else. And then five, people's secondary knowledge. That's the main difference between people. An example would be whatever your profession is, you know the rules of it, so you know how to do it. So the conclusion is people use their abilities, needs, and primary knowledge to achieve their desires. Okay, so next, the U.S. existing land condition. There's 100 trillion square feet that exists and 4 trillion square feet used, 96 trillion square feet unused, and you can verify that with government statistics or an aerial view in a plane. Okay, so I'm switching over here. So number five, a quote by Abraham Lincoln. He said, the land, the earth, God gave freely to man for his home and support. It should never be the possession of any one man, corporation, or an unfriendly government any more than the air is. Okay, next is land's natural value. It's really priceless. It's so valuable you could say it's like worth $1 billion a square foot, just in theory. Today's existing land value is an example would be your mortgage, which is like one-third of your salary over a 30-year period. That's the rule for most people. Next, wealth acquisition today is, here's like a family, the average family, and their thoughts are, we compete and work hard for money to buy our sources of life. And the results are 1% rich, the green, about 25% middle class, the yellow, who live like an okay lifestyle, and then 74% live a bad lifestyle. Our time, we spend 75% of our waking hours working and 25% for play. And then the environment has a lot of war, crime, and disease. Then next, the law. It's life and liberty is guaranteed by the government, and it's stated in the Constitution and the Declaration of Independence. And we need a combination of all sources of life to have life and liberty. So just an initial theoretical plan, every family inherits 1 acre of land, so you're guaranteed food, shelter, etc. Because, you know, without food or shelter, you don't have life, and the law clearly states that everyone's guaranteed life. Okay, then what an informed person is, they have the same desires as the people today, which is love, safety, happiness, etc. Their abilities are the same as today, think and act, their needs the same, we all need land. Their primary knowledge is different, it's I inherit land and resources because they're my source of life and I die without them. And I'm a free person but dependent on sources of life just like everyone else. And again, the main difference between people would be the secondary knowledge. So then we use our abilities, needs, and primary knowledge to achieve our desires. So the only difference between an informed person and today's person is their primary knowledge. So how wealth acquisition would work tomorrow, here's a family. Their thoughts are, we inherit plenty of land and cooperate with each other to have a great life. So the results, living conditions 100% great, time, spend 75% for play and 25% for work. Plays the orange, blacks the work. And then the environment is safety and health. And then just a couple things. This idea about people inheriting land, it's not a new idea. It was proposed by Lincoln, Thomas Jefferson, John Adams, Thomas Paine, and many other people. They all said for society to work well, everyone needs to have their own piece of land so they can have survival and happiness. And I'm just going to go through a couple of common questions that people say after I make this presentation about like people inheriting land. So a lot of people say, where do I get my land? My response would be, we'd set up a land draft. An example would be, every family picks 5 locations around the country where they want to use their acre. An example would be, I want to use 7,000 square feet in Illinois, 5,000 square feet in Arizona. People could also do a timeshare program. This is obviously just broad strokes, but to get the point across. The next question, who decides who gets what land? You know, what if 2 people want the same piece of land? And my response would be, people exercise common sense. They have a discussion and determine. Plus, there's plenty of land to go around. It's like 2 people wanting the same Mercedes when there's 100 that exist.
I don't think that.
Okay. And then I'm going to move on. Okay, this next board describes the different type of land that exists. So starting with the prairie and forest, they account for 60% of the land in the United States, which would be 60 trillion square feet. Swampland takes up 5 trillion square feet, which is 5%. Mountains take up 3 trillion square feet, the deserts 12 trillion square feet, the tundra 20 trillion square feet, and then the earth is 2/3 water. So resources included but not limited to all these lands are manufacturing minerals, wood that can be used for housing, cotton for clothes, a farm for food, steel and iron for cars, and copper for comfort source like heating, air conditioning, plumbing, and electric. And with manufacturing minerals, those can be used to make laptops, iPhones, TVs, etc. So there's actually enough land and resources for 7 trillion people to live a millionaire lifestyle. That's a simple mathematical equation to prove that. Forbes magazine from October 15th, 2011 states there's a 2 million year supply of metals, and Lane's the original source of life and wealth. Then on the back, I'm just going through what's done with each piece of land, plus the water. So with the water, about 6 months ago on Channel 7 News, there's a guy who's got an idea to make a floating island on Lake Michigan. It's called Breakwater Chicago. This next picture is a hotel, underwater hotel in Dubai. And then this next one is a cruise ship that people go on vacation on for months out of the year. With the tundra, these are cities in Alaska, Russia, Norway. Out of the desert, there's Las Vegas, Phoenix, Arizona, Los Angeles. With mountains, these are cities built on them in Italy, Spain, and Arizona in the mountains. With swampland, Disney World was built on it, same with Chicago and Boston. And then prairies and forests, these are just some more pictures showing that cities are built there. So again, the United States existing condition, there's 100 trillion square feet of land, 4.5 trillion square feet used. The breakdown for that is residential, there's 1 trillion square feet used, and the math is there's 100 million homes at 10,000 square feet per property. Apartments and condos are included. For agriculture, we use 1.5 trillion square feet. It's like 1 acre feeds 10 people for a lifetime because it regrows every 3 months. For defense, 1.3 trillion square feet's used, and then everything else, manufacturing, commercial, schools, hospitals, etc., is 700 billion square feet. So again, usable but not used is 95.5 trillion square feet, and you can verify that with aerial view or simple math. And then since land supply is abundant, why is it so expensive? It's just a question I had. Okay, this next poster is just a theoretical example. So let's say we've got $1 billion in the bank, but no resources. We're gonna die. We can't eat our money or build a house out of money or wear it. And then on the bottom, the scenario is we have no money, but an abundant supply of resources. We're gonna have a great life. So people still have a house, food, etc. But they don't have any money, but they can still live. Again, it's just theoretically speaking, and it just shows that land and resources are king, not money, because it's just a piece of paper. Okay, this next board is the broad strokes history of Ireland's living conditions. And this can be applied to any country, just FYI. So Ireland, the assumption is God or nature created it. There's 920 billion square feet of land slash source of life that exists. And Irish people used 3% of it to live in 2015. And again, the sources of life are land, air, water, sun, labor, knowledge, money. They're all equally important today. So Irish people from 300 to 2015, their abilities are physical and mental, their desires are nice living conditions, and their needs are a source of life. So the year 300, which is like when they say Ireland was first occupied, the law was that Gaels, a group of people, owned the source of life, land. The business system was produce source of life 99% of the work, manage business and government was 1%. The living conditions for the time were good for 100%, and the important fact was there was a great cooperative living system. Then in 800, the Vikings conquer, steal, and own the source of life. The business system changes to produce source of life 10%, manage business and government 90%. The living conditions are bad for most, okay for some, and great for 1%. And the important fact was the Vikings conquered the Gaels. Then 1100, the English king conquers, steals, and owns the land in Ireland. It's the same business system and living conditions where it's bad for most, okay for some, and great for 1%. And the important fact is Ireland was conquered by England. Then in 1210, it's the same law where the king owns the land, the business system is produce source of life 10%, manage business and government 90%, and the living conditions are the same. Okay for some, bad for most, and 1%, great. And the king tells Irish people they can use their land as long as they pay him rent. 1594, the law, business system, and living conditions are the same. The important fact is the 9 years' war. Irish people said we can't beat them, so we join them. They say the English king gave the Irish leaders land so they wouldn't start a war anymore. 1650, again, same law, business system, living conditions. The important fact was Irish people wanted their stolen land returned. Okay, then 1802, again, same law, business system and living conditions. The important facts were Robert Emmet emerges as a hero for Ireland. 1840, same law, business system, living conditions, and there was a lot of uprisings, and a lot of Irish leaders said anything short of land return to the Irish is a failure. 1845, the same law, the King of England owns the land, the business system, produce source of life 10%, the other 90%, and then living conditions the same. The important fact is there was a potato famine and millions died, and the crown did that intentionally. 1916, everything the same. The important fact is the Catholic Church preaches to accept and conform to the English. 1972, same law, business system, living conditions. The important fact is Bloody Sunday, there's a protest and 26 Irish people were shot and 13 died. In 2015, it's the same law, business system, living conditions, etc. And the important fact is new information's discovered. So this is like a theoretical in 2015 where the law is Irish people own the land, produce source of life 99%, manage business and government 1%, and living conditions good for 100%. And the important fact is it's a new law. Instead of a small group of people owning the land, it's everyone owns their own piece of land. This was an important document in Irish history. It's called the First Isle. It was written in 1919. But the summary of it was Irish people should own Ireland, use nature in a way that benefits all Irish people, and seek to cooperate with other governments to create great living conditions for people. So the conclusion was Irish people were never able to get their land back because they were always outmatched by the British military. And again, this description applies for about every country like Italy, Germany, Spain, Mexico, France, etc. They all faced the same problem, where there was a ruler who owned their land and they were, you know, in poverty. They fought back, but they never won because they were outmatched.
He's going too slow. I wish he'd go.
Okay, this next presentation board is an analysis of how our economic system works. So it starts off as a theoretical town in 2015 called Cassius Kingtown, and I apologize for the small writing. The circumstances are 80,000 families of four moved to a vacant land to build a town with the guarantee of a good paying job. People agree it's a free market with the government, and the parents' average age is 30, and for the kids it's 4. The existing condition is, let's say 100 billion square feet of land exists, 3 billion square feet's used. It's like the size of St. Louis. The law slash people's knowledge, it's capitalism, no communism or socialism. People compete in business for money, cash is king, and people have religious, political, speech freedoms guaranteed by the Constitution. Economic freedom's not guaranteed, but all have the equal opportunity to get it. So the job breakdown for the 80,000 workers is 32,000 people working construction, like building the houses and the cars for people, 28,000 work in business, like in stores, management, etc., and then 20,000 people work for the government. So the results after 2 years, the construction's 40% complete. The living conditions are 1% great and 99% okay. It's like everyone's making $100,000 a year. That's the average salary. And then the time, people spend 75% of the day for work and 25% for play. And the environment's safe since everyone's got a good paying job. So Year three, the progress is at 60%, year four, 80%, and year five, 99%. So year six, 40,000 workers are laid off because the construction is complete. People's savings will be wiped out after 6 months. So the new job breakdown is 50% of the people are unemployed, 20,000 work in business, and 20,000 work in government. So the living conditions change where it's 1% great, 25% okay, and 74% bad, since a lot of people were just laid off. In the environment, it's dangerous now because people lack money, so they resort to crime to get their source of life. Year seven, layoffs continue because less people have money, so businesses have less demand to produce stuff, so that forces them to lay off workers. And there's just more unemployment, but it's the same living conditions, time, and environment. And then year eight, the town shuts down because people don't have any money, families leave and go look for more work. Okay, this next example is called Nature is King Town 2015. It's the same circumstances, existing condition, and the law slash people's knowledge is different. It's called nature capitalism, no communism or socialism. People cooperate in business for survival. Sources of life are free because they're abundant, and that's just following the law of supply and demand. And people are guaranteed every freedom, including economic. The job breakdown for the 80,000 workers is 1,000 people work in government since they're much more efficient in this system, 72,000 people work in construction, and then the remaining people work in business. So the results after 2 years is the town's 95% complete. The living conditions are 100% rich or great because there's plenty of things produced so everyone can access them. And the time breakdown is people spend 75% for work and 25% for play. And it's a safe environment since everyone's doing well economically. Year three, the construction progress is at 99%. Year four, it's a new job breakdown. The people who worked in construction are laid off and they get new jobs in research to improve life, like coming up with better machines or inventions or cures to disease, etc. And then the time changes to 25% for work and 75% for play since a lot of the big work's done and there's just not that much to do.
Yeah.
And then it's also the same living conditions and environment. And the town stays like this till it's conquered by Cash is King people. So just to recap, the same in Cash is King Town and Nature is King Town. There's the existing condition is there's an abundant supply of land which people would die without. People use the law and their body and minds to achieve their desires, which are safety and happiness. And then to go through the differences, in Cash Town you compete in business for money, in Nature Town you cooperate in business for survival. In Cash Town you use your labor knowledge to make money to buy land and food from a king. In Nature Town you use labor knowledge to buy land and to acquire land and food from nature. And then an example of Cash Town is any and all towns or cities in the world today. And an example of Nature Town is it's not possible. So just to clarify, some people say Nature Town's communism or socialism, so I just wanted to clearly define them so people get that. So nature capitalism is multiple ownership of source of life. People get land for free and consume through cooperation and efficiency. It's freedom. And capitalism definition is like a single owner of the source of life. The king gets for free and sells to labor, which is like 100% of people, for consumption through competition and inefficiency. It's kind of like slavery, where everyone's a slave to the king.
It's good solid.
And then this is Slavery Town, 1840, of how like a chattel slave system worked. I'm not gonna go through it, but basically, in year eight, the results are the same as the Cash Town, where a lot of people are unemployed, the living conditions are 1% okay, 20% good, and the rest bad. And the town shuts down after year eight because there's no more demand for work. So the same in Slave Town and Cash is King Town. The existing condition is abundant supply of land. Most people worked hard and live in poverty. A king owns the source of life. You need money for your source of life, otherwise you starve. And they fail after 8 years. The differences are in Slave Town, slaves worked for a master, they could be whipped, and they didn't have any freedoms, religious, political, etc. In Cash Town, you work for a business owner, you can't be whipped, but if you don't have money, you can starve, which is just as bad. And then you also have religious, political, and legal freedoms, but only 1% have economic freedom, which is really the most important one of all, because without that you can't eat. And this next one is a description of the Great Depression in broad strokes terms. So the problem was people were suffering economically. The reason? There was no access to source of life because there was no money, because there was no jobs, because there was no money demand, because there was no cash investment, because there was no opportunity to invest to make cash. The law was source of life is private property, you need cash to access. And then this was just a quote by Roosevelt. To summarize it, he basically said, economic freedom is the most important freedom because without it you can't eat. All other freedoms are secondary. So the existing condition in the Depression was 100 trillion square feet of resource-filled land existed, and the use was 1 trillion square feet. And there was plenty to go around, much more than people could use. And 99% of people were willing to work 8 hours a day because they wanted to provide for their family. So people's mindset, their goals were safety and happiness, their abilities were physical and mental, and their knowledge was, the law says source of life is private property, you need money. So then just to show a picture in the Depression, the law was, you need money to access your life source. So here's like a house, education, hospital, food. It's all private property, no trespassing, with soldiers guarding it and a fence up around it. So here we're people, we've got no money, but an abundance of our resources, we're dead. And an example was in the Grapes of Wrath, where people were trying to get food and there were soldiers there guarding it, and if they tried taking it, they'd get shot. And then going to like an Indian system, where it was freedom, paradise, no depression, from like 8500 BC to 1491 in North America. The existing condition was an abundant supply of source of life. The law was people work 3 hours a day cooperatively, producing and distributing the source of life, and the results were 100% great, have sufficient source of life, and life was great. So again, there was 100 trillion square feet that existed, and less than 1% of it was used. And then if you looked at the Indians' mindset, their goals were safety and happiness, their abilities were physical and mental, and their knowledge was, the law says, source of life is free, we just need to cooperate with our labor and knowledge to access it. A lot of people say that's not true, Indians were constantly fighting with each other, but if you read like the People's History of the United States by Howard Zinn, he stated in their records of Indians getting along fine and having a great life before Columbus conquered them. And just from a logical perspective, since there was an abundant supply of source of life to go around, it really wouldn't make sense for other tribes to fight each other. And then just one last thing, Ben Franklin said, if five nations of Indians can live together in peace for 1,000 years, he was referring to the Iroquois, then certainly 13 colonies of English people can get along. So that was something he said. And then just a picture, just kind of showing the Indian system. Here's like their house, education, store, medical, etc. Obviously they didn't have it exactly like this, but it's just the concept to get the point across. And their thoughts are, we have no money, but an abundance of five things that money buys. We're gonna have a great life with soldiers and their families. So everyone's kind of united. Okay, so the government's solution during the Depression was limit the food supply so prices stay high and there's less jobs. And the New Deal, which was basically welfare or subsistence, so some people didn't die. But back to limiting the food supply, the law was called the Agricultural Adjustment Act that was signed in 1933, where the government paid farmers not to grow food so the prices would stay high. So the results of that law were many people died and lots suffered. So that was really a stupid and inhumane policy that the government implemented because it hurt a lot of people. And then this is just kind of my thoughts of what the government should have done to solve the problem of the Depression. They should have gave unemployed people unused land because there's an abundant supply, 99% was unused. so people could apply their labor and knowledge to produce their sources of life, food, house, etc., from land, instead of letting valuable assets go to waste and suffering instead. So within 2 years, people would have had fully functioning cities that met all of their needs, and there would have been a depression. What this would have done, it solves the problem, government does its job, it manages process of ensuring people get their source of life. They take over from there and have life and liberty by working smart. And people aren't a burden on the government, they're taking care of themselves. It's a win-win-win for taxpayers, government, and unemployed people. Okay, so this board kind of talks about the poisons in the environment. So it starts with a clock, like when we're sleeping in the sheets and pillows and mattresses, there's a lot of chemicals and pesticides. When we're brushing our teeth, there's fluoride, which was used in the atomic bomb and rat poison. When you're taking a shower, there's a lot of chemicals in the water, like arsenic, mercury, etc. Eating food, there's a lot of additives, high fructose corn syrup, MSG, etc. Breathing in air outside from cars, they release carbon monoxide, which is toxic, and then etc. But the point is, we're poisoned 24/7 around the clock. So small doses of poison are maliciously and unnecessarily added to our life supply, food, air, water, etc. So we consume that stuff, and I think the aging process is accelerated by 1%. I'm not really sure how much. An example, carbon monoxide, if you breathe it for 15 minutes in a non-ventilated area, you die from poisoning. But if you breathe it in for 80 years in a ventilated area, you still die from poisoning.
I got about
2 hours left. Okay, so that was my presentation. Does anyone have any comments or questions?
Okay. Rob's going to help you moderate the questions and call on people, but I'd like to...
Might as well retain it. We'll start with Carl Schwett. So I gather that you want everybody to have some sort of land to be productive on this land. So what do you do with like handicapped people and like retirees at some point, you know, they're not going to be able to be productive? I don't want to live out of the farmland. I want to live in the city. And maybe one more thing, the internet provides jobs and does things without using land or building and that, so where does that fit into this?
Well, without land, there'd be no internet. So that's my response to that question. And as far as like old people and handicapped and mentally ill, there'd be a system in place to take care of them, just like there is today, like Social Security or their family would take care of them. So as long as people are, you'd have to take care of people who can't work.
Yes, not Gene Horton.
Just like we do today.
Very interesting. Have you heard the name Henry George?
Yes.
Okay. And have you read any of his books or any?
I've read some of his works, yes.
Thank you.
He was a big proponent of land being the source of life and everyone should have it.
Tim Bolger.
Are you familiar with the works of Hernando de Soto and the book called The Mystery of Capitalism or The Mystery of Capital?
No.
And how about the succession of land reforms that occurred in Japan in the 1945-1947 time frame or some of the other things that worked?
I'm not specifically aware of their land reforms in Japan, but I would say that they didn't work because the Japanese people still had to pay someone for it, a third of their salary over 30 years, taxes on the land.
Okay.
Dave Travis?
Yes. Are you familiar with the works of Ayn Rand?
Somewhat, yes.
Well, she pointed out that under capitalism, people work, They make money, they live, they can have land if they want, or live in a rented apartment if they want, and that everybody gets along okay.
Well, results in society would disprove that, because there's a lot of poverty, crime, suffering in general. People are dependent on money, so no one's really free under capitalism. Everyone's a slave to money, because if you don't work for money, then you die.
You don't have money.
If you don't have money, then you can't buy food, house, etc.
Answered all right. Your questions. Let's see, Mike Lehman.
Did you say it was 100 trillion acres in the U.S. or in the world?
100 trillion square feet of land in the United States, and in the world, I think it's 1.6 quadrillion square feet, which would be 37 billion acres worldwide, okay. And in the United States, it's 2.3 billion acres.
So, did you want your charts mention how much was farmland?
Yes, like in the United States, less than 2% farmland. We use 1.5 trillion square feet for agriculture.
That's it?
Yeah.
No. Yes, Charlie.
How much you use, not how much available.
No, there's 1.5 trillion square feet of 1.5 trillion square feet used for agriculture, but 100 trillion square feet of land exists.
Yeah.
How much room for agriculture? How much farmland exists? 60 trillion square feet?
Yeah.
I mean, the whole states of Ohio, Indiana, Illinois, Iowa are all farmland.
60% is farmland.
Yeah, like 60% of the United States is prairies. So I guess they prairies or farmland.
Yes, Charlie Paydock.
Yeah, Tom, you have to connect everybody.
Okay.
I mean, I want to visit my friends up in, who chose tundra for some reason as their land. Where's your infrastructure?
Yeah, most of the lands you don't want to be on in the world.
I got mine in Vegas on the Strip.
Okay.
How do I visit that? Isn't there commerce between...
Yeah, you could build airplanes or spaceships to get there. Kind of like people build today.
Jetpacks. They were talking about.
Well, I was just giving an example of all the different types of land, and no matter what piece of land you look at, it's got resources that we can use to produce what we need to live, and people live there. There's functioning cities built on every piece of land. Well, that was my point.
Yeah, but land value is relative to what's near it, such as a transportation mode.
Location.
Sure, but with unused land, you could build stuff on it that would make it valuable. So all land has the potential to be very valuable. It's just a matter of people using their knowledge and labor to build things there. Just like Chicago, before it was built as a city, it was just a piece of land until it was swampland.
Yeah.
Ayala.
Yeah. Your examples, and maybe there was some tools to it in primitive society and then feudalism. But today, with this complex society, how do you reconcile the information age? Today, the ecology is basically information. How do you reconcile it with the need for land? What would I do with land that will make me happy?
Whatever you want. If you wanted to have a house there with your family, or the city there with your friends.
I live in an apartment, mm-hmm. which is a very efficient way of living today. So. I own very little piece of all this.
Okay, if you didn't want land, if you were happy in your apartment, then you could just stay there. So people don't have to move or anything. They can stay where they are if they don't like this other option.
Yeah, but how How is it related to happiness?
Land? How is land related to happiness?
Yeah.
Because it allows you to be alive so you can do things with the people you love and be happy.
No, no. The farmers need land, right?
Correct. To grow food.
Okay. And perhaps some businesses and buildings and resources to build need a piece of land, which doesn't have to be good land to grow things. Not every land grows stuff.
Well, actually, every land can grow things. Like in the desert, they have greenhouses there to grow food there. They can also do that in the tundra. And so I would disagree. All land can grow food.
Have you been to the Egypt, the Sahara Desert?
No. There's water underneath it, though. So Arizona's a desert, and they turned it into a nice city. So you could theoretically do the same thing with the Sahara Desert.
Dubai.
Dubai. There's plenty of examples of desert areas that have been turned into nice places. Like I went through Las Vegas, California, Arizona, Dubai, Egypt, etc.
I have a question.
Sure.
And that is, I noticed that you didn't have any specific agricultural population of work being done.
I'm not sure what you're referring to.
Well, in when you function to the amount of work being done, including farmers.
I think I did. Maybe I didn't read it. It was included in business where it's producing food, stores, education, etc. That's
food
obvious.
Was included.
Sorry if I didn't include that.
Yes, Michael?
Two-part question here. What's the overarching point of the presentation? Is it that land, more land ownership by the whole population is better, or is there some overarching other point? And then where else are you doing these presentations?
Okay, number one, yes. If everyone owned land, I think that would solve our economic problems and in turn crime. So I'm a big proponent of everyone owning their own piece of land. And other people I make this presentation to are politicians, educators, a lot of black people, priests, college students, different organizations, business people, lawyers, policemen, firemen, basically every type of person. I try to talk to everyone since this relates to everyone.
How long do they own the land?
Till they die. And then it gets passed on to their kids, kind of like today.
Well, kind of, but a little different, since you don't have necessarily an inheritance factor. Are inheritances taxed?
No.
There are no taxes?
No.
Ah.
You don't need money.
Oh, you don't need money.
No, you need labor and knowledge. Just kind of like when I went through that picture of, let's say we had $1 billion but no resources, we would die. But if we still had a bunch of resources, like the food in the room, we would be able to live, even if there was no money. I know a lot of people can't wrap their minds around that. You can't imagine a world without money. But if you really thought about it, you'd find that it is possible.
So you falter? Let's say for the gas and the electric resources.
Like I kind of explained in the Nature's King Town example, it's like that example is 80,000 workers cooperating to produce all the resources they needed. So it's like a big team effort. So everyone who works is compensated adequately. So you divide the tasks based on who's good at electric, etc. And plus there's a lot of technology and machines that can be used to do that stuff.
Martin?
What form is the compensation there?
Resources. So today
and you get paid in pigs?
You get paid in house, food, clothes. Yeah. So today you work, you get paid money, and then you go to the store to buy food.
I thought there was no money.
No, I'm just trying to explain how it works today. So today, people work, they get paid money, and then they go to the store to buy food. And the system I'm proposing, it's you work and you go directly to the store to get food. So it's kind of cutting out the middleman. People produce it and transport it there, just like today.
And the motivation to do this is what?
Survival, that they get food. Just, it's the same incentive today. People work for survival today. In a new system, people work for survival. And if they don't work, then they live in poverty. So it's a pretty strong motivator.
But will they get caviar?
Can you tell them how land works today, where somebody owns it all and everybody buys it from them, and how it would work tomorrow?
Sure. So again, as I explained in the towns, in the cash town, there's basically like a king or a ruler who owns all the land because he's got this divine right, and then he forces everyone to work their lifetime to pay for land, which is basically the system we have today, where there's a small group of people who own it all, and everyone else works to pay them. In the new system, it's everyone owns their own piece of land, and they get it for free because nature or God created it for free, and there's no sense of paying for it.
How do you get to the new system that you're talking about?
People get together and unite and demand that this be a law.
All right.
Can you lobotize the people?
I'm sorry, what?
Yes, I am.
How can you lobotize those people to do, it sounds like a machine that you're describing and giving people the credit that everybody will cooperate with this system, right?
Because it would produce such good results for their family, whereas today it's crappy results. People have no problem working today, and most just get by. In a new system, you work and you live a great lifestyle. So it's a much better system that appeals to people. At least to me, anyway, or anyone with common sense.
Okay, this side of the road seems to be rather quiet.
Didn't get that way yet.
Carl. I wanted to know, where do like creative people fit in the system? You know, people that like write movie screenplays, write books, and you know, how would they function in the system?
They would still do those things. Like in the work breakdown, it'd be a lot of people in research and development to improve life. Like, well, that's where the creative people would fall under. Come up with good ideas and entertain people, etc.
Michael.
Are we all going to have to go live on our acre of land somewhere and start farming?
No.
Okay, hold off for a second.
It's reform because people want to, and it's mutually beneficial.
In Cashtown, people work so they can get money to buy food. In Nature Town, people work so they can get food. So it's really just the same thing, except there's no money factor in Nature Town.
No middleman.
No middleman.
Right? Okay. Tim Bowles.
All right. What is your medium of exchange in Nature Town?
Labor and knowledge.
How is that going to be translated? Say I'm a carpenter or a fish maker. How am I going to get my wife's dress? Do I cut a deal with the labor through barter? Do I go to a store and buy it? How do I translate my labor to that good?
There'd be a big system in place where, you know, you're a carpenter, someone else is producing food.
There's no carpenters. Because
of machines, I guess. Yeah, like I said, I'll just say it once. Machines can do a majority of the labor. So that wouldn't come up.
So explain to them. What would his wife do?
Yeah, what would my wife do?
Research and development to improve life.
What would she do to get the dress?
Go to the store and get it, because it would be there waiting for her.
Okay.
How? Why would someone produce this machine or any machine without knowledge of the likelihood that somebody would need it?
They produce the machine because it's a good way to produce things, so they get whatever they need faster, quicker, more efficiently. They do it because it's in their benefit. It's not like the system is, you know, I have to serve other people and I don't get any benefit out of it. It's, no, I work and I'm benefited substantially.
Oh, David?
Then are you saying to each according to his need, from each according to his ability? Is that what you're saying?
No, it's everyone does, everyone is working and they get whatever they want whenever they want. So just to clarify, because I know this sounds like communism.
To each according to his need.
It's people working get compensated greatly. That's what it is.
That's a really... to each according to his need.
Well, here, let me address that. So that sounds like communism, something Marx said. And basically in that system, he says there's a central bank where everyone's dependent on cash, there's no inheritance, but government owns everything, people don't get anything, and there's a high income tax, and the results are 1% live great, 5% live okay, and 94% live bad. And under, you know, nature...
No, Marx said that there ultimately there would be no money.
Well, I read that he said there would be money.
Well, you must have read a different book. Sorry.
If you Google it, that definition
right,
of communism.
Another two-part question. What inspired you to spend the time and effort to look into this topic? One, and then two, you know, this system is in place already in parts of the city, and parts of the city government gives plots of land to people to grow fruits and vegetables, and I see it in different neighborhoods all around the city. So it's really in place in spots. That's not their sole source of income, but so there is a possibility that, you know, maybe that would be a good way to solve the unemployment rate is give people land.
So number one, about like 5 years ago, I found out there were a lot of poisons in the food, water, air supply, and that really, you know, scared me because it's bad for my health. So I researched it to see if there was a healthy alternative like organic or anything, and it turns out there's not. So that was a big motivation. And then after I discovered there's a lot of poisons, I found out that we just live in a slavery system. Everyone's a slave to cash. And that's why there's so many problems like, you know, crime, poverty, etc. And I know
there's a lot of bad jobs out there.
The people who try to solve problems today, like activists and politicians, they just want to work within the system to solve the problems, and scientifically they're never going to be able to be solved that way. And I don't see anyone else proposing what I propose, which I think is the only scientific solution.
Explain, Bill.
You know, the EPA is taking, that's why we have the EPA. It doesn't get publicized in the media, but they're the people that are taking poisons out of every freaking thing in the country. And they should get some credit for that.
Well, they do a terrible job because no matter what you buy.
There's a lot of polluters out there. And there's a lot of polluters.
Just go outside, for instance, the air. It's all poison. And you could look on any ingredients, and there's aspirin.
It would be 10 times worse if the EPA wasn't around.
Not the dialogue here.
Okay. Question time.
And just another comment. A lot of my work is based off the book of a guy named Edward Bellamy. He wrote the second most popular book in the 19th century called Looking Backward. It was the second most popular book behind Uncle Tom's Cabin by Harriet Beecher Stowe, and he wrote a follow-up book called Equality in 1897 before he died, and that really explained the root cause of the economic problems and the solution. So everything I'm saying is the same thing he said in his book, and it was really interesting, and it's a great book.
$3 trillion to the stock market.
Tell them that the EPA is run by
If
Eagle
there
people.
Are no more questions, we will move to the, Andy Anderson.
Did I miss it, or did you have a coherent plan for addressing how do you expect to move to this kind of a society? How do you expect to deal with the billionaire criminals that own and control much of what we have today?
Okay, the billionaires, that's like a group of a million people, and then everyone else is like 7 billion people, so 7 billion people versus a million people. Obviously, if the 7 billion people are informed, they can get whatever, they would defeat the million people. And it just starts by informing people until, and hopefully this would go viral, kind of like a negative news story, like the Charlestown shooting, or the vice president's son dying, or 9/11. Where people find out about a bad event in 24 hours through the media, internet, etc. So it would kind of be the same format for this, if it ever happened.
Do you want a revolution?
No, just a fair law, so people have good living conditions.
But how do you get it without a revolution?
People come together, they use their heads and say, this would be a law that would be beneficial to us, so we're going to make it.
So everybody votes?
Yeah, everyone votes on it, I guess.
Do you understand power and the forces that want to keep...
Yeah, people are the power, they just don't know it.
No, not right now.
Because they're stupid. Once they are informed, if they came together...
Okay, that's it.
We shall inform them.
So, 7 billion people together are powerful.
Not the way power is distributed today. They're potentially powerful.
Because they're stupid. That's why we're not united, and that's why we're powerless.
Okay, so what will make them not stupid?
The truth.
Okay. All right. Do we have any other questions for our speaker?
Yeah, let's...
Yes.
Are we free people, or are we slaves?
Slaves.
Well, anyone I thought slavery was illegal.
In theory, but people allow it.
Oh.
If you work for any amount of money, you're a slave.
Oh, yeah. I feel like that sometimes.
Okay.
People might not want to admit it, but they just be immune to a fact.
A slave to whom?
Money. And the people who control money, who's like the Federal Reserve Bank, they create money and lend it to the government, and that puts people in debt that they can never get out of.
Yes, all right. If that resolves all your questions, we will move to our...
I got one.
Yes, okay. Charles?
What if I take my acre of land and I grow genetic corn on it and use fertilizer?
Then you'd be stupid because you'd be poisoning
it. Is it illegal?
I guess it'd be illegal to do that because it poisons...
I had a little issue with everything you identified as a poison.
Okay, like what, for example?
I mean, it has to be more than a feeling in your heart. And the government establishes, I rely on the government to tell me what is poison and which isn't. As much as I rely on the government to identify what is in fact medicine and what substances are not. And these have not been identified.
Well, there's actually plenty of studies.
There's a thing called permissible exposure levels. And I even on fluoride, I was somewhat surprised. Which, as far as I know, gets rid of tooth decay. You want people to have bad teeth?
No, that just because they say it gets rid of tooth decay doesn't make it true. There's a lot of people, former people who worked for the EPA that did studies that proved...
The John Birch Society?
I don't know the exact name, I could send it to you.
Yeah,
but there's plenty of scientists who say it's not good for tooth decay. And it was used in rat poison in the atomic bomb. I don't want to be brushing my teeth with that. You got to research both sides to get to the truth, not just blindly follow whatever the government says.
All right, Gene Autry Anderson has the
question. Well, the alternative is everyone gets land and has a great life, or we just stay slaves and most people just make it. So if people just want to have a crappy life, then I guess that's what we're going to have. And never come up with solutions.
No one has shown GMO to be bad. We have the speaker here. Now, why can I grow it or not?
How come so many people protest it, like the March
Madness? Can I grow it or not?
If it's poison, you can't. If it's not, you can't.
What happens if I do?
If it's poison, then you grow it, you go to jail. Very simple.
Oh, I have the answer.
Just like if you kill someone today, most go to jail.
Why do you grow and peddle genetically modified food? Because. It's cheaper for the growers to use the genetically modified food to grow it. And the other, the distributors of the genetically modified food can charge more more money for non-modified food. Well,
okay.
Which they are currently doing.
People shouldn't be allowed to use poisons. That should be illegal. It's really all I am.
Well, okay.
All right. Gene Autry.
When I was 12 or 13 years old, my auntie said, boy, use your head for more than a hat rack. And when I discovered and subsequently were able to absorb that information, it made me feel good. So when you explained, you did that research and all that and so forth and so on, I'm thinking like, oh, he's a good person. Do you think I did the right thing? Do you think I'm normal when I feel good using my head for more than a hat rack? Would you say that you did it for some other reason other than to be to feel good of doing something that you wanted to do?
I didn't quite understand that. Could you state the question? Right.
Why
did
you do it?
Well, somebody asked you. I could just hear guess and say, well, that's an educational project that you did the research and so forth.
Sure.
Then I could also say, and when I get this thing there, I will mention something. I also say that a young dude like you go out and do this kind of research, to me, could make me jump and shout, and he could be jump and shout. Why? Because that was something he did using his head other than a hat rack. So compliment.
Okay, well, yeah. Thanks. I'm doing it to try to get the poisons out of the environment so I have a long, healthy life, and so I have great living conditions and I'm not a slave to a piece of paper. Those are my two main motivations for making the presentation.
What's wrong with a hamper?
Okay.
All
right. Brahma.
Robert, did you have a question?
Oh, me?
Yes.
No.
Okay. All right.
Fine.
Let's go to rebuttals,
okay.
Brahma. It's almost 8 o'clock.
How many have rebuttals? One, two, three, four, five, six. Six, at least seven. Yes. All right. How much time do we have left?
About we got about maybe an hour and 10 minutes before 9 o'clock. We could probably go 5 minutes each on rebuttal tonight.
Certainly, 10 minutes at least for rebuttal. So 5 minutes. You can use up to 5 minutes for your rebuttal.
Let's thank our speaker.
Thank our speaker.
Yes.
Okay, and I'll get.
All right, and Gene has the first rebuttal.
Well, thank our speaker. I thought it was an excellent presentation. It reminds me a lot of Henry George. I think it would do the speaker good to read some of the. Go through the Henry George courses. Henry George did have somewhat of a different system. The land was actually owned by the community. You rented a piece if you wanted to use it. If the land was unused, you could simply use it. As far as Edward Bellamy, I did not read all of Looking Backward. It's a very boring book, in my opinion. But I think it's pretty much of a socialist system. Also, it also reminded me a lot of my visit to New Zealand about 12 years ago. I think it was about 12 years ago. It is a country where they do lease the land a lot. And Carol Moseley Braun, I remember that. When she was ambassador to New Zealand, she said she was ambassador to paradise. And then this lady was dumb enough to then run for president of the United States. She should have said, I'm ambassador from paradise.
But that maybe that's why she didn't win the election. But anyway, it was an interesting presentation. I think Henry George also used a lot, did use money extensively. But I think in Edward Bellamy's book that was not done. I'll have to go back and read Edward Bellamy's book, even though it's boring. Thank you.
Equality would probably answer your question better than looking back.
My name is Doug Binkley. Some of you have seen me here, and I've mentioned that I worked with the Citizens Party back in the 1980s, and that was a party that favored the environment and favored social justice, as the speaker does. And I want to congratulate him. When I was his age, 19, I had kind of similar ideas. They weren't quite as well thought out as his are, and but over time I realized that it is a very complicated thing to come up with a really program for how to arrive at a society that has social and economic justice in it. And we have a terribly broken society, but there is a lot of complications in getting to that society of social justice. And there are little things like, well, yes, if everybody had an acre of land, that's a good idea, but I had thought of things like, well, you could have, you would still have some kind of a system which resembled money. I don't know how we get completely away from that. It will take generations to get to that level where we have that brilliant society of the future, if we survive all the cataclysms that we're maybe going to have from global warming, who knows. But it's very complicated to reach that. It's hard to get through to people, as has been mentioned already. The internet may be of some help, I encourage you to work on your ideas and work out the kinks in them. And I lost my train of thought there briefly. I thought there would be a system of some kind of credits. We maybe not call it money, but we would try to get to a level where it was contributions to society that would be valued more than money, not just people like the Koch brothers, because they're so wealthy, have this power, which is part of the brokenness of our society, but that people would have genuine ideas, the people that write books and plays and have good technological ideas, not technological ideas to siphon money from other people or just do it by paper pushing or pushing data in stock manipulation or whatever, or just making money off of a market, but actually producing things. And people who did not want to have anything to do with cultivating land, or they would prefer to be city dwellers, all those complications could be worked out within your system, I think, as you say. So I support your ideas, and I'm very grateful that there's such a fine young person as you. And trying to do things that are good. Thanks.
Thanks, I appreciate it.
Young man, you did a nice job. In fact, I was looking at the schedule and I saw your name and they said, oh, 19 years old. I said, oh shit, I got to go down to the college complex tonight. I said, I'm heavy set. But when they said 19, I said, let me get down here, because he ain't old enough to be robotized. He wasn't raised on Russ Limbaugh and wannabe Limbaugh. That was a subject that a young 19-year-old man decided that this is what I'm going to do some research on, not because your professor told him, because he felt that this was something that he could use and something that he could digest, something that made sense, and something was better than just wearing a hat for your head. You can use your head for other things, like being intelligent. Now, when I asked that question, and it was convoluted, and maybe I should do some research and learn the language or something, but anyway, I was almost saying, does this, when you go out and research something like and put it together, and is so comprehensive that you can take it and say, well, I can go among the people and give a speech on this. And you did a good job of that. So I was serious when I'm asking, does this make you feel better? Do you have some kind of emotion in that? Or is this something that you forget about tomorrow and do something else? Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi everybody, my name is Tim. I am Tom's dad. I notice that most people can't get over the thought of not using money because that's the best medium of exchange. However, is there anybody in this room who could tell me, money is the most important thing to everybody in their lives, or one of the most important things. Can anybody tell me how money is manufactured and how it's sold, how it gets into the marketplace? And where it ends up. So everybody, money is the most important thing to everybody, but nobody knows a freaking thing about it. Is that right?
We just can't explain it in 1 minute.
I could explain it in 1 minute. Can I?
Yes.
Okay. Basically, how the king used to make money, or anybody, they'd have their slaves go get some coins, whether it be, they get gold or silver or copper. The slaves would make the money for free. Let's say they made $1 million. They'd give $1 million to the king, so the king got $1 million for free, and then the king would lend the government the money, and the government would say, yes, king, we accept your money on these conditions. We'll pay you back principal and interest, and king, we're going to enforce your law for you lending us this money. So the government employees enforce the law, and then they get paid the money, and then they go to the store, the king's store, and they buy food and house and clothes and whatever they need to live. And then the king gets all the money back in profit, and the people are broke at the end of the week, and then the king said, oh, by the way, you guys owe me $1 million for principal and another $1 million for interest. So it's just a terrible Ponzi scheme type system, but nobody is aware of it because nobody does any investigation or knows any facts about it. So if everybody would get educated on how money is created and how it works and how it causes all these terrible problems in the world, then everybody would clearly see it's a big Ponzi scheme. And it would be on the news, and it would be over in 4 hours, and we could start a new life of peace, prosperity, safety, and health for 100% of families. No more suffering for anybody. Okay. Thank you.
All right.
Nice job by the speaker. You put a lot of time and effort into that. And it was good to think about how land is used as value and what it's worth. I took Economics 101, 102, a couple more classes. So you print money and you set it out there. That's the money supply. And money's kind of a good thing. You put a value on it. The hamburger I had tonight had a value.
You learn.
Your car has a value. A trip on the CTA has a value. So it's a good way to account for things. And
that's what the king told you.
But, it's easier to use than barter. Anyway, we were in a barter society years ago, so we switched it to money or coins or whatever, trinkets or something to trade. One point I wanted to make out about how this money corrupts and how Wall Street, well, first of all, money's printed by the government. It's out there. It gets lent. It's given to banks, and then the banks have to pay an interest rate to the government, or the Treasury, or the Fed. And then the big banks lend it to the little banks, and the little banks lend it to the littler banks, and then the littler banks give mortgages and car loans, and everybody's paying a little percentage. And that's how money is dispersed, and that's how it goes through society and so forth. Anyway, but the problem is that comparing the Depression, this came back up to mind, we printed as much money in the last 8 years since the Great Recession started, or 7 years. We printed as much money, put as much money into circulation as we did during the Great Depression in 1930 dollars. The only problem is, in the Great Depression, we built things when we put that money into circulation, roads and bridges and schools and libraries. You still see a lot of that today out in our infrastructure. So, but this, the last 7 years with the stimulus going to Wall Street, that $3 trillion, it went to the same guys that screwed up the economy in the early 2000s. It went to bankers and brokers, $3 trillion. And then we got to disperse it. And then a lot of, you know, all my clients here in the North Side, these kids, these hedge fund managers and stockbrokers, and they're all so rich because they got a chunk of that $3 trillion of your tax dollars. So, and it resulted in another bubble, another stock market bubble coming down the pike. So, anyway, so I think it's a system we've got. It's working in societies all over the world, money, and, you know, there's a lot of crappy minimum wage jobs out there, and, you know, you just try to find a niche where you could get ahead or flip stocks and bonds or flip real estate or be like Rom or Rauner. They flip the businesses. They flip the business I was in to become millionaires. So, with that, I'll end, and I'll say redistribution today, redistribution tomorrow, redistribution forever. Thank you.
He's
a communist.
All right.
Just tax Tupperware.
Go to Russia. Tupperware for everybody.
I'm fine with capitalism.
Go to Russia.
Tim Bolger.
I have not heard, I know what you guys are trying to do with the redistribution of wealth, the elimination of money, and the whole bit. The bottom line is that there's always going to be some form of means of exchange or money involved. And the essence, let's just start from the beginning. When somebody owns a piece of land in the United States today, they have something called a title document. That title document represents the value of that land, which that title can be used to transform it into other purposes. You see, the land itself has value because you could farm it, you can do with it, you can live on it. But also at the same time, that land has another value to it, in the form of maybe ownership. I'll take this for example. This is my wallet. Everybody knows it's my wallet because I carry it around, and yeah, my niece made it, but it is my wallet, and it's been implicitly agreed upon by the rest of the people that your wallet is yours because it's in your back pocket. Most people know that my car is my car because the key that I have to it fits in the ignition of that car, and I have a legally registered car title with the state of Illinois saying that it's my car, and if somebody steals it, I can go prove it by going, you know, by pulling in some form of ownership. Now, I don't have the car title, it's owned by the bank because I'm making payments on that car at this point because somebody had the foresight to loan me money to buy that car. So the title, in a sense, is mine, and it will be mine once the loan is paid off. Now, I've refinanced that car title at least 3 times to get out of some credit card debt, but it's still my car, it's still my keys, I still enjoy the use of that car, and once the loan is paid off, I'll have that car. because I was able to get a loan for a car title based on my credit report and credit score, I was able to use the capital that was made and invested in that car, not just for transportation, but it took a double life, meaning that I had a loan on that car. The same thing applies to capitalism. You don't have distribution of wealth, foods taken care of, people doing things without some form of money or medium of exchange. I have often said that the only reason capitalism exists is it's a form of trust. This dollar bill represents nothing more than blind faith that you put value on it. We all value this, so it's a medium of exchange. Governments do print money. There's nothing backing our money today. But it still is a matter of a dollar bill. Most of our money today is in the form of electronic bits in the computer or in the form of a medium of exchange. And even today, you're seeing the non-money money in the form of Bitcoin being used much more around the world to transact business. In the black economy, Bitcoin is used probably more than the dollar bills and the electronic transfers of money ever have been. What is really needed in a book by Hernando de Soto called The Mystery of Capital is not less capitalism, not redistribution of wealth, but governments actually recognizing who owns what. In Egypt, for example, it takes about 17 years to get clear title on a house. In the U.S., that's usually less than a day or two through closing and closing costs and the transfer of a real estate deed and perhaps even getting a mortgage on that home because it was built and it was then, but eventually you're going to own it once you pay that mortgage off. That system has only really existed for the last 100 years in the Western economies. Hernando de Soto, in his book, translates the reason why capitalism works in the West and not in the rest of the world. And it's because of that enforcement and succession of property rights. First off, the government getting people to who they own, who owns what. After World War II in Japan, there was a massive effort to register the property, to make sure who lived on the land owned that land, and then once that land was able to be bought, sold, monetized, commoditized, that's when you started seeing economic activity take off. Now, the most interesting concept that I've seen to make people not so dependent on money and maybe not so dependent on work was something called the existence income by a certain senator in the 1960s. Because you're alive, you have a certain subsidy of, say, a few hundred dollars a month that if you don't want to work, you don't have to work, but you'll still have your basic food and shelter and all this in the form of a subsidy for life. And, you know, a lot of people, that might be the one way to take care of it purely and simply. Hey, you're alive, you're entitled to a monthly stipend. What really, I believe, is needed is not much less capitalism, but much more laws in the form of land reform, in the form of regulation of business entities to ethical behavior, and the simple fact of, you know, we do have a lot of cheaters at the top in Wall Street that are not engaged in ethical practices. We didn't have a recession because of the lack of money or credit. We had it because it was all based on a lie. The false valuation of home prices that was systematically imported from the credit rating agencies to the Wall Street barons to everything else. And because of that false valuation, the house of cards came tumbling down. The problem was is that if we let that house of cards come tumbling down, we would have seen the world essentially collapse. And that was why there was the bailouts given to certain Wall Street firms. No, I didn't like it either, nor did a lot of Republicans either, who would have preferred bankruptcy, nor did a lot of Democrats, but it was what had to be done to keep the system afloat. I find it very funny how, in one hand, we don't have compassion on the poor. Because a lot of that $9 billion, if we just put it in every man, woman, and child, would have been out maybe about $20,000 each per person in the U.S.
$3 trillion.
And that could have maybe been much, much better helping people weather the storm.
Oh, yeah.
Now,
yeah,
the one thing that I would like to see is that we are, in a sense, solving our own problems. We are, in a sense, moving forward more. We've been doing that for some 300 years through the process of industrialization and capitalism. When you have respect for the rule of law, you have respect for property rights, and you have respect for the local government and government authorities, you prosper. We see it in the United States, we see it in Eastern and Western Europe. We're not seeing it in a lot of the other developing countries because the laws that the governments have are corrupt. They don't recognize the fact that property rights are there. They say somebody else owns all the land, but the peasants on it are this way. What's needed is simple. If you read the book by Hernando de Soto, he was fighting a group called the Shining Path. And when the local indigenous people in that area finally got title to their land, they were then able to say, okay, I have a stake in this. You were right about one thing. When people own land, they have a stake in it. Where you're wrong is the simple fact of that the incentives that are able to be used by it, that parallel life that takes place when you can monetize and get a mortgage and go to the bank and do other things, that's where everything moves through. Money, you may not like it, you may not think a king runs it or whatever, but in a lot of ways, it's the most convenient form of determining valuation, pricing, rents. All you gotta do is just, hey, it costs this much, you have it, and it's there. Prices go up when commodities get scarce, they go down when commodities get really big. If there's a high demand for something, a business comes in and fulfills that need. Personally, I can't think of any better self-regulating system. It's much like when Mikhail Gorbachev was talking to Margaret Thatcher. You know, Mr. Gorbachev, you determine the prices of everything in the former Soviet Union. My job is easy. I don't have to do it. The prices are automatically determined for me. The medium of exchange works. The problem we're having now is not one of the money itself. It's not one of the things. Your system, you say some other type of valuation is going to come in. Well, that's ultimately going to be another form of some kind of money. You're going to have a valuation in the forms of goods and services so that carpenter who wants to buy a dress for his wife can go to a store and say, okay, this much, and I have this much for this, this is what this is worth, and that's how it goes on. Now, in the determination of value itself, yeah, I'll wrap it up. Okay, anyway, to make a long story short, capitalism works because of the intrinsic value that's placed upon the finance of money. I highly recommend reading Hernando de Soto's book, The Mystery of Capitalism.
It really works.
I'm afraid that I have not read deeply and enough of Karl Marx, but I know that he was a really well-studied philosopher and a journalist. He was concerned about society, and he was a philosopher of freedom. He was a neo-Hegelian. He believed that history was dynamic, had all sorts of forces in it, that one way of living might succeed another, and did, that we evolved our social relations and our economic relations, and that most relations were based on material circumstances, those of the economy. He wrote on capital particularly, but he also, in later life, also wrote on ethnological and anthropological studies, and he's a thoughtful man. Henry George was a popularizer of his a sentiment of anti-landlordism, and he traced all wealth to land ownership. That, unfortunately, was too narrow a concept, I think. After all, how do you get land ownership? The concept of ownership is one that has evolved. It's been different in different parts of society, whether in Ireland or anywhere else. If you want a good deal of our society has been based on the family. Family relations, personal relations, social relations in small groups, of bands, in more primitive societies. We call them primitive. Actually, they may be quite articulated, quite developed in their own way, both in language and concepts. And art forms, all sorts of developments, art, technological, even the stone chippers had a science to their art of making stone tools, and but not to dither on too long. The state, that is, the prevailing rules and regulations of society, and their enforcement by the society or elements of the society, is a question of how it evolved and why it evolved and how it can be changed. The question of how you can, like Ralph Bellamy, think of many forms of society that might be more advantageous or less advantageous. The question is, what do you have in a society, and how is that society developing and functioning, and how would you like to change it? How can you change it? For that sort of question, Marx was very, very particular and very critical of many other socialists, of whom there were many in his age and today. You can be an authoritarian socialist or a libertarian socialist. But the thing that's common to socialists is that you want a better society, and you look for ways and means of developing one. Okay, and those are the questions that I think must be addressed.
All right.
Alright, you guys are putting me to sleep. Come on, Andy. You want to go ahead, Andy? I'll tell you what, I'm going to get them warmed up for you, Andy. It'll be here too long. Alright, let's thank our speaker once again. Thank you for putting in some time, effort, and thought. I'll be eclectic as usual in my comments. Alright, a little lesson. Let's begin where this all came from. In the 18th and 19th centuries, the philosophers began looking at something called happiness, or man's relationship to the world. And previously, we had a Christian worldview. It was a static worldview. But they began looking at this. In particular, the French, guys like Rousseau. What is the relationship of an individual to the community and to the ones in charge of that community? What was the situation here? People actually began to look at it. Prior to that, they accepted that the universe has well-defined a hierarchical structure. God, angels, saints, da-da-da-da-da, monarch, people at the bottom. The universe ran rather clock-like, the seasons, and the only thing, event that was going to happen was the second coming, a thousand years ago. Now the German guys came along and they added a new twist to this too. Not only did they say, let's look at the structure of the relationships, they also threw in a thing that it had some sort of thrust to it, or direction, it moved in different directions. So they gave it movement. They said, let's look at the whole structure, and does it go any direction? Which direction is it going? And the fancy term for that would be like teleological. Is there an endpoint? Which way is directed? You can hear this later in some of the German philosophy in the 20th century. We have to do this in 1,000 years and things like that. Along with the French were some notions, and there was looking at this, what brings about happiness, genuineness, and authenticity, and understanding goofy French society. They actually came back, and something that you came up with, they said, oh, the nature, that must bring about happiness. They actually thought possibly the happiest person was a milkmaid. And a bard. I'm not making this up. They actually, we after that would dress up like a milk, him and her and her pals would dress up like milkmaids. You know? Because they said, this is the purest form of human spirit. Now there are other serious utopian movements, utopians. I know I'm familiar with Bellamy. I actually got out of looking up too. I only came across him a little bit. Interesting guy though, he had some things there. There were other utopian efforts at the same time. I've been down to New Harmony, which is an interesting operation. The Amish, of course, is still in business. I've lived with those folks. And the Shakers, you know, you could hear it in the Shakers. This thing about nature and things of this nature, 'tis a gift to be simple, you know, gift to be free is their theme song, their national anthem here. Okay, but that takes care of the utopians, various means of restructuring society, whether that be a capital society I'll get into. One thing about, what is this thing about mortgage and land is such a wonderful thing. Listen, you got to get away from mortgages. You know, this thing about, well, one-third of your income for 30 years. I mean, they're talking about a yoke that you're putting on. I mean, that's the antithesis of freedom. You got to get away from that. Now, regarding our little thing here about this book you recommended, now you recommended what was this book on the South America? What was it?
Was made in Peru.
And everybody got an acre of land, and then we're happy, huh? Like those conquistadors down there just decided one day, right, according to the book you read, and said, let's give land to everybody, huh?
Do you know why they gave land to everybody? In the book you read, you didn't tell you this, is that these guys called El Camino Luminoso, the Shining Path, came along, and they went along to these aristocrats, who conquistador types, who had all the land, and they put a bullet in their head. And that's the only thing that brought it about. And then, yeah, these guys were ruthless. And the other side were even worse. They would capture the guys were looking for land reform, and if they caught one of them, they would beat them up, put them in a cage. This is what they were up against. The guy, this wonderful little thing back there, they would capture one of these revolutionaries, beat them up, beat the jeebies out of them, and then they put them in a cage and put them on a truck, and they would take them on a tour around the towns and say, listen, if you want to misbehave, you can join this guy. So this is what this guy wrote, version of this history here. It's a little different. Now, the last thing about land is, you've got to look at your fundamental premise here. And the cash, whether you have a society uses money or not, the one thing about money is that it has a pretty much agreed on value. But in your system, you've got a problem here. There is no way to say that each acre of land is of equal value. As a matter of fact, when I was thinking of it, this is a system that your basic mind will organize it on. There virtually are no 2 acres of land on Earth of equal value. Now, you're going to have problems here. I mean, in using that. Now, the last thing is, and I'm a greenie, you can't take an approach to nature, and I hate to sound like some kind of Republican guy, but you can't say that you get the land, but it didn't sound like you can use it, because you would do something that is poisonous. Now, even though I'm a greenie, I couldn't concur with, we had these doctor here, even at the college, and they came along with the eco movement, and the basic premise was, if you were sick, that illness was due to something in your environment. Mm-hmm. Like all illness was due to an environmental situation. You got a big doctor here, I don't know. But they took it to an extreme, and they would say, look around your environment. Now the basic problem with that is, if you live in an antiseptically pure environment, does that mean you like live forever? And given the condition of my apartment, I should have been dead about 3 weeks ago. And I mean, my cats might make it, but I'm just out of here, man. Anyhow, that's just a few things to talk about. Yes, I will trust the government to determine what is poison or not. And they're pretty good. They use some real solid criteria, a feet on the ground approach. They do a pretty good job. Mike was talking about it. If they identify some hazardous situations, I can't even think of an example when they've gone to the extreme on these things. I've worked with them personally. If anything, they do maybe tend to err a little bit on the side of extreme, but I would rely on their judgment regarding permissible exposure levels to things like this. Believe you me, that's a very inexact science. And in regarding certain substances, and to be blanket, as a basic thing, believe you me, it's a tough one, especially when you take respiratory type things, solid substances. This is just not quite there yet. I don't know, and never will be, because there's a continuing development of substances in our society that they can't keep up with. You know, certainly, what happens is we lag behind, and things are in the environment that shouldn't be. All right, that's it. Thank you very much. That's fun. All right, Andy.
All right, Andy.
They are immune to the truth. I can tell.
Okay.
This guy in particular. Yeah. El Camino Lumino. Oh, lots of. Do you want land, senor?
Charlie?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Charlie, when you check the websites, you're completely wrong and misinformed.
It might seem like a free land.
You're missing four.
I have a question for our speaker.
All right, let's let Andy go.
Project or a thing called the Zeitgeist Movement?
Jack Fresco.
Jack Fresco, because your presentation sounded a lot like what he's proposing for a new global system that actually uses resources to help people. And did you mention that during the speech or no? I'll mention it now. There's a website for all of you out there. There's you want an update, really comprehensive overall view with videos and everything of what our speaker talked about tonight. It's called the Zeitgeist Movement, and on there, there's also a website called the Venus Project. .com.
The Venus Project.
Venus. Like Venus the planet. The Venus Project.com and the Zeitgeist Movement in general. These people are working toward a global movement to implement the program he talked about tonight, while as more and more people are reaching a critical mass, like our speaker is waking up one day and understanding that the present system isn't working. You have to be pretty much blind, deaf, and dumb to keep going along with thinking that our present form of billionaire predator capitalism is the best way to run the planet. As I talked about before, if you don't have time to read the last 100 books on our climate problems and current problems, all you need to do is get one copy of Professor David Ray Griffin's book, Unprecedented. It's new, came out about a month ago, and it summarizes a lot of what our speaker was talking about tonight and the solutions as people realize that the grandchildren that are here now, kids that are 2, 3, 4 years old living on the planet right now, they have no chance for a viable future 50 or 60 years from now if we as adults and everybody else that's aware and thinking, if we don't do something, mobilize and change our system and stop destroying the environment, then these kids are going to be living on, trying to survive on a planet. The survivors will be living on a planet where the sea level has risen approximately 20 meters, which is 60 feet. And people will be migrating inland by the billions, and it'll be a totally different world for centuries to come. And future historians will look back on our society and say, why couldn't people mobilize when the scientific evidence was so overwhelmingly clear, documented, and undebatable? As I mentioned earlier, we have a concept in this country where people on a variety of issues, people will continue to believe a myth and promote the myth long after the reality has been totally documented beyond any kind of debate. Promoting the myth in after the facts have been documented is what is called the tobacco strategy. The tobacco industry pioneered the technique of paying university professors to produce studies. Basically, you pay a professor to produce a study saying the earth is flat, and then you give him $250,000 for his hour of testimony before Congress. The media promotes it on all channels, the earth is flat, the earth is flat, and they simultaneously run a coordinated blackout on Albert Einstein and 500 of his friends from the physics department saying, hey, the earth isn't flat, we got pictures from the space shuttle. That's just an analogy, an example, but right now the same people that promoted the tobacco strategy are the same people that are being paid by the fossil and fuel industry to promote climate denial and to promote the idea that the next generation of nuclear power plants is our savior. I just came back yesterday from an energy conference up in Wisconsin.
And there's a group called Nuke Watch. There's a group called Helen Collicott wrote a book called Nuclear is Not the Answer. There are famous people all over the world. Scientists have been researching this stuff for 30, 40 years. Are saying that every dollar we spend on nuclear power and fossil fuel is a dollar that could be spent on clean, green energy that's now cheaper, that could move us forward. If you go to any energy conferences anywhere, you will see that at current prices, our own Commonwealth Edison, believe it or not, put out a report 2 years ago in January. It's been 2.5 years. ComEd said that by the middle of 2015, that's now, rooftop solar energy will be cheap or cheaper, as is competitive with utilities in 42 states in America. There's a rooftop revolution going on of people putting up solar panels and you know, getting their electricity off the roof and drastically scaling back how much energy they buy from the local utility. It's a total revolution in progress, like the revolution that happened fast when people reached critical mass and said, let's have smoke-free restaurants. I don't know if there's anybody here other than me that remembers that you could get into a fist fight 30 years ago if you asked somebody to put out a cigarette smoking next to you in a dinner. Does any, show of hand, anybody remember that? When people say, it's my God-given right to light up and puff away anywhere. I don't care about your rights to breathe. Well, knowledge moves forward. Knowledge moves forward in the direction of truth. You know, Gandhi said it. An idea whose time has come goes through four stages. One, they ridicule it. First, they ignore you. Then they ridicule you. Then they fight you. Then you win. You cannot hold back an idea whose, if it's truth and reality. It's what's called the Galileo learning curve. Galileo was first with the theory. Basically, he went public and he got arrested. But people came along behind him with telescopes and said, hey, he was right. And then 304 years later or something, the Catholic Church issued an official apology
There's
for persecuting
no
Galileo.
Secondary what? Smoke, harmful.
Charlie, that's an immunity to facts.
No.
That's an absolutely, and Charlie just gave an example of somebody who is absolutely immune to an overwhelming body of evidence and data that's been proved all
there
over the world.
There is no danger for
secondhand smoke. It has all kinds of effects on children with asthma, breathing problems. There's no scientific debate on this at all. So, you know, we have to show compassion to our less educated people that are living in a bubble of mythology. You know, they'll get there eventually.
Why not just make some restaurants designated for smokers only then?
Sure. Why shouldn't you?
So to you know, summarize what I was trying to say. There's a variety. For those of you that want documented lists of references and things, come to the presentation July 25th. We're gonna have some top 10 fact sheets from three different decades showing how evidence was solid on certain critical issues, and the media is still blacking it out. So there's beneficial programs going on all over the world solving problems. And what you described is the Venus Project, basically, the global strategy to move us away from what Tom Hartman, the historian, he says it almost daily. He said, we're in the 35th year of Reaganomics since 1980. Our country's in the 35th year of Reaganomics, and we are living in the, we're living proof right now in the greatest failure of a governing ideology in the history of the human race. If you shovel money to rich billionaires, some of it will trickle down to the middle class. Well, that's not working. And more people, like our young author tonight, more and more people are waking up and realizing, hey, you know, this isn't working. This is fantasy land, and we have to do something about it. So I commend our speaker and all other young people everywhere that are trying to use their energy and whatever resources they have to make a difference. I think it's fantastic. So thank you for the presentation.
Okay.
Thank you for the speaker.
All right, Tom.
Me?
handy if my neighbor sets up a Weber grill. Can I tell him to shut it off?
No, just go over there and suck in the fumes.
Our speaker gets the last word. All right, let's give our speaker his full attention for the last word.
Okay, so starting with the gentleman in the White Sox hat. Sorry, what's your name?
Thoreau. Mike.
Mike, okay. You said I took Economics 101, and they say the foundation of economics is scarcity. You know, that's the reason you need money. But as I kind of proved, we have an abundant supply of land, so that just shows you don't need some medium of exchange because there's an abundant supply where you don't need to regulate it. Like, what do we regulate? What medium of exchange do we use to get air or sun? Nothing. We just take it for free since there's plenty to go around. It's the same concept with land. Since there's plenty to go around, you don't need to regulate it. People can just take it for free. You said the government prints money. It's actually the Federal Reserve Bank that prints money. It's not a government agency. It's a private corporation. You said, oh, the system works fine, but, you know, it's a lot of war, poverty, crime, and disease. It's always been like that, and as long as we use the system, it will always be like that. And you also said, like, you know, Wall Street, the bankers, they're the problem. They're just people working within the system. It could just as well be someone else. I think it's the system that's the problem, not individuals working in it. And then next, Tim, you kind of, I think you said I was proposing redistribution of wealth, like taking from the rich and giving to the poor. No, not at all. Just for distribution of wealth, taking unused land that the government, which is the people, owns that they don't use, and instead they should use so they have good living conditions.
It's the Indians' land.
Yeah, I guess originally it was. And you said, like, you know, this is a great country, anyone can get a loan. That's just the slavery system where the king owns the land and people don't have money, so the king says, okay, I'll give you this privilege where you can get a loan and you just have to work 30 years to pay me back. I consider that slavery. And it also sounded like you thought that you're still compensated in the new system even though you don't work. That's not how it would work. It's you work and you're compensated. If you don't pull your weight, then you don't get compensated because it's just not fair. And then you said the system works fine, capitalism, but you know 80% of the world lives in poverty under the buying and selling system. So I think that's proof enough that it doesn't work.
Well, two thirds of you have just had a radical bit of growth in the early 2000s with the development of equivalent of two United States coming online.
China, I think that's a India. Bunch of propaganda they feed people so they think things are really getting better.
It's proven by statistics.
Yeah. All you have to GDP. Do is go look at people's living conditions. Last word. Just look at people's living conditions. They live in lots.
It's a lot better in Bangladesh than it used to be. Yeah.
Well, what were the living conditions back then, and what are the living conditions today? It's all the same, no matter where you go.
And then, Charles, you said, you know, freedom is a mortgage, one-third of your income for 30 years. That there's nothing wrong with that. I think that's blatant slavery. There's a good quote. If you own things that men must have to live, then you own the men who must have them. And anyone, if people own land, then they own other people. I think freedom looks like getting land free from nature, just like we get air and sunshine from nature. You said money has agreed upon value. The value is people work for it or they die. And you said, you know, there's no 2 acres on earth that are equally valuable. I vehemently disagree with that. As I showed with that land board, all land has resources and can be used to live there. I don't know how.
I don't want tundra.
Like I said, you have resources. You don't have to have tundra. That only accounts for a small percent of the total land on earth.
Tundra from northern Ontario.
Well, I can't.
You use tundra for resources and everywhere else you live.
Yeah, you don't have to use the tundra for living there. You can use it for other.
He's got an acre of land on the strip in Vegas, and I get tundra.
No, you wouldn't have to get tundra if you didn't want to.
you get land where you want it, since there's plenty to go around. But I didn't do a good job of explaining that.
Well, doesn't everybody get an equal share of each amount of land?
Yeah, you could also balance it out like that.
What does that mean,
Jack? And, you know, people say, like, oh, change is going to happen gradually, but people have been saying that for thousands of years. Like Henry George, he said in 1880, change isn't going to happen in my lifetime, but hopefully in the next generation's lifetime. It never happened, and all social reformers say that. It's not going to happen in my lifetime, but maybe in 100 years, and that's never going to come true. It's either going to happen in a 24-hour period or not at all. And then lastly, with Andy's point, yeah, I was kind of saying things similar to the Venus Project, and they have some good videos of explaining how a new society would work. And there's tons of alternative energy, like water-powered cars. Stan Myers in 1995, he invented that, and you know, he died mysteriously a couple of years later. There's also air-powered cars. They had on the Shark Tank show with the investments, an air-powered car like a month and a half ago got an investment. So that's just the mainstream reference. And Tesla said there's an unlimited supply of electrical energy we can use, and Einstein referred to him as the smartest man alive. The reporter asked Einstein, how does it feel to be the smartest guy alive? And he said, I don't know, ask Tesla. So he really liked that. So that was my rebuttals.
All right.
Thanks
thank
for
you.
Letting me.
Before we go, I'd like to thank this guy again for coming up before us. And I think we should give him another round of applause for a good job.
Thank you.